Isabel, okay. I want to get paid the same as a man, and I think you understand that. So, if you become president, will a woman make the same as a man, and do I get to choose what I do with my body? Isabel?
You're going to make the same if you do as good a job.
Jared Maupin gets his weapon. You might recognize him as a high-profile organizer in the minority community. Just last month, he led marches on Phoenix Police Headquarters after an officer shot an unarmed man.
We want his badge! We want his gun! We want his job!
Today, he accepted an invitation to look at things from the other side, agreeing to go through a force-on-force training session with the Maricopa County Sheriff's Office. A call of two men fighting.
What's going on today, gentlemen?
What's wrong with you?
What's going on today, gentlemen? What do you want? What's happening here?
What's wrong with
back
you?
Back up.
Huh? What are you doing, man? Hey.
Hey, you shouldn't approach me. He shouldn't approach me.
He shouldn't approach me. He shouldn't approach me. In there.
Yeah.
What are you doing? You just shot him?
I didn't understand how important compliance was. But after going through this, yeah, my attitude has changed.
Can you really call it a culture? For example, we've got some people who speak Spanish in Canada, but we don't live in a Spanish culture. So some rapes happen, but we don't live in a rape culture. We don't live in a culture that supports rapists.
Of course we live in a rape culture. Of course we do. This is a rape culture. What we live in today is a rape culture. And that's what needs to stop.
Then what does the media and our politicians do to help rapists?
More lenient sentences, a slap on the wrist, which happens all the time.
Okay, give me some examples of that.
You know, I'm not here to give you specific examples, Lauren, but I know that you know, and I know from experience from watching you, that you know exactly what I'm talking about. And I don't need to go into details because I don't have any specifics.
Hashtag.
How you feel when you be the hashtag?
Hashtag.
I have done my research. I've done my research.
You're fucking old. You're fucking a white male. Yes. In America. Yes. Look at all the fucking black people that are Mexicans. That's not a fucking issue compared to the black people that are police. Bullshit. The white guys are right. You're a white man. This is fucking bullshit.
The dominant narrative in America is white people are evil, white people suck, we should be ashamed of ourselves, and
I don't think we should be ashamed of ourselves. I think that we should take responsibility for the system that we've created.
The best system in the world?
We do not have the best system
in
the world.
Who has a better system?
There are many European countries that are much better off
than
us.
Oh, you mean like the European countries with a higher density of whites, like Northern Europe?
Gotcha, bitch!
That's one way to phrase it, I guess.
You don't mean Turkey.
No.
You don't mean Eastern Europe
no.
with the communists. So the only time you can come up with a system that's better than America, it's a country that's more white than America.
Smoke weed every day.
Fuck it right in the pussy.
You don't mean Turkey.
Hold up. My niggas who be thinking we saw me.
I take this opportunity, if you all saw me on Facebook, I'm that bitch that was gonna flame y'all, and I'm sorry to say that you claim that this is free speech, but in actuality, I have a point of view that you may or may not respect, and you did not allow me to have a platform to do that, so I can't.
Do you have a question?
My question is, if rape culture is a myth, then explain why Kesha was not allowed to break the contract with her executive when he obviously raped her.
I'm not going to comment on an individual case that I know nothing about. You're obviously better educated in pop culture than I am. I'll have to pass, I'm afraid.
Basically, in 2015, what's left of sane society rejected the argument that fat, ugly, obnoxious land whales were in any way desirable, attractive, or healthy. Fat pride militants enjoyed weeks of positive press coverage during their campaign of vandalism, harassment, and even bomb threats directed at Protein World. All because the company dared to use a thin and healthy model for their beach body ready advertisement. But Protein World did the unthinkable. They refused to bow to mob intimidation. They refused to apologize. The result? This relatively small company made well over $1 million in 4 days just from all the free publicity. They then unveiled an identical skyscraper-sized beach body ready billboard in New York City. The fat acceptance movement was dealt a huge blow.
You're simplifying the issues that were on the plate of the nation at that point. I mean, we were looking at going, reverting a depression at that point. Everyone, the Fed chairman...
Well, I disagree that we were going into a depression, but go ahead.
Do you have a degree in economics?
Yes, ma'am, I do. Highest honors.
From Belgium, it's called Sirens, and it is described as an irreverent feminist manifesto for the 21st century.
Drink it, and you're fine. It's not like Mexico, you go and get sick. If they provide free health care, a dictator provides free health care, I like that dictator. If he provides university and education for everyone, I like that dictator. But Cuba has the highest literacy rate in all of Latin America, including almost California, okay? You guys came here and genocide a lot of people, right?
Yeah,
because that's what you like. You like to invade countries and kill everybody, right?
It's a frightening and disgusting trend in the world of online gaming. Hackers rewriting code to simulate sexual assault.
Online, they can take your character, lock them in place, have made their character pantsless, and then can simulate sexual assault with your character, and you are helpless to stop it.
The graphics are so good, this attack is eerily realistic, but this is virtual rape. Hackers rewriting codes and hijacking online video games like Zombie Apocalypse and Grand Theft Auto. The vile scenes are then posted to YouTube.
That's deplorable and should not be allowed anywhere. Like, they should be banned off the servers immediately.
And Sam Meggs, an avid gamer and blogger, tells me in some cases, these hackers, also known as modders for modifying the game, will talk to victims on their headsets during the attacks.
When you can hear the person on the other end who's saying these things directly to you and they're saying them directly to you, that's a whole other level of harassment, really.
It is certainly something that we would be, you know, interested in hearing about if people have experienced it.
In this scene, a dog has been modified to do disturbing things, and Detective Sean Marshall, who investigates cybercrimes, tells me this new trend is hard to label.
Are there charges that could come along with this?
We do investigate cases where people are being bullied online or being extorted online.
Sam Meggs stopped playing online over a year ago because of what she calls a misogynistic mentality that already exists in the world of gaming. And she says these new rape scenes only illuminate that.
It's violating. It's triggering for people who have survived assault in the past. It's a visual representation of all that terrible verbal stuff that you get as a woman online.
My fear is that the whole island will become so overly populated that it will tip over and capsize.
We don't anticipate that.
Hello, Clementine. You're fantastic. It's lovely to hear someone else who's as enraged about the way things are as I am. I feel quite enraged often. It's nice to have a justification for that. My question is...
You don't need me to tell you to be justified in your anger, by the way. You are justified in it. You only need yourself to tell you that.
Professor Melissa Click was caught on tape calling for muscle to silence members of the press attempting to cover the story.
Well, you need to get out.
No, I don't.
You need to get out.
I actually don't.
All right. Hey, who wants to help me get this reporter out of here? I need some muscle over here.
Donc si je vais sauter aujourd'hui, c'est pour prouver à tous les hommes qui n'ont pas choisi de filles ou de femmes pour ce défi que les femmes aussi ont assez de courage pour sauter dans l'eau et ont assez de cran. Voilà. Bon, quand je parle de sauter dans l'eau, c'est pas un petit orteil, hein, mesdames. C'est sauter entière dans l'eau comme des hommes. Voilà, j'en profite aussi pour faire passer un message. Si je saute aujourd'hui, c'est aussi pour lutter contre les inégalités hommes-femmes qui persistent dans notre société actuelle. Donc à mon tour, je dois choisir trois personnes qui vont devoir sauter dans l'eau. Sinon, elles vont devoir me payer le restaurant. Donc forcément, ces trois personnes seront des femmes, comme je suis là pour défendre les femmes. Donc ces trois personnes seront Élise Bove, Elodie Darras et Julia Minet. Voilà, donc je n'ai qu'une chose à vous dire.
Allez les filles!
I am unsafe here for all humans. Be quiet! For all humans, please. You understand that? As your position as master, it is your job to create a place of comfort and home for the students that live in Silliman. You have not done that by sending out that email that goes against your position as master. Do you understand that?
Then no, I stop. Don't agree with that.
Then why the fuck did you accept the position?
Because
who
I have
the fuck hired you?
I have a different vision.
You should step down. If that is what you think about being a master, you should step down. It is not about creating an intellectual space. It is not. Do you understand? Here. You are not doing that!
You're supposed to be our advocate!
You should be at the event last night when you hear her Franco say that she doesn't know how to create a safe space for her freshman in Silliman! How do you explain that? These freshmen come here and they think this is what Yale is? Do you hear that? They're gonna leave, they're gonna transfer because you are a poor steward of the community. You should not sleep at night.
We're out, we out.
You are disgusting.
When you're against people, then people don't want to vote for you. Mm-hmm. But if you're for people like LGBT, African American, Hispanic American, etc., women, and their privacy, and leaving them alone when they need to be left alone, and helping them when they need to be helped, like here in South Carolina. Look at Barack Obama. He won Virginia twice, almost won North Carolina twice, lost it barely the second time. And South Carolina? Mitt Romney only won South Carolina with 53, John McCain with 52. That's a changing South. Those old white people, they're going to die someday. And who's going to be there to replace them? People that want you to be for them, not against them.
You know, Timmy, maybe you should run for office. It's a pretty good rant you had.
so it's not exactly a fandom. I'm not a fan of video games. I actually had to learn a lot about video games in the process of making this.
In dozens of third-person games with playable female characters, the character's butt is brought to the forefront, and that's where the player's focus is directed. In Batman Arkham City, for instance, the player's gaze is drawn to Catwoman's behind.
I am the feminist who is out to ruin your life. I am the feminist who is ruining your perfectly respectful marriage by suggesting Audre Lorde to the book club that your wife attends. And yes, I am the one who convinced her to get that shorter haircut that you pretend to like, but don't really like. I am the feminist who is pushing your daughter down the slippery slope of sluthood by giving her a high five when she says she keeps her own supply of condoms. And incidentally, I've tried to turn her bisexual by recommending some dental dams. Yes. I am that hysterical feminist who demands trigger warnings on scenes of rape and violent sexual conduct. Yes, I am that militant, man-hating ball buster who insists on opening the door for you just because I made physical contact with it first. I am that ice queen cunt who responds to your street side compliment with her most frigid, "I didn't need your comment." I am out to infringe upon your rights and freedoms and extra room on the subway bestowed upon you for having a penis. I am absolutely a threat to your way of life.
It's a Twitter war turned trial for a Toronto man who was arrested for allegedly harassing two women on the social media site. But Elliot disagreed with the two women's campaign to publicly shame the creator of a video game where you punch a feminist in the face. The Twitter war broke out. The two women said in court they felt creeped out when Elliot continued to interact with them on Twitter, even when they said they blocked him. Now, systematic or continued unwanted or annoying actions falls under the legal definition of harassment. Elliot tweeted, "At Lady Snarksalot, how'd you feel if I was so delusional to ask you to not retweet me? You want control? Use your email, not Twitter." But a judge will decide if you can control unwelcome comments on Twitter, or at least criminally prosecute the people that make them, even if they aren't necessarily threatening in nature. A decision is expected October 6th. If guilty, Elliot could face 6 months in jail. A verdict, Elliot's attorney says, could have serious implications.
From a real lady for once.
I hope you guys
were paying
23%
more than me. Why not consider the possibility, the radical notion, that you could be wrong?
We want an open conversation of ideas. You guys can't be grown up enough to literally wait 10 minutes to the point where we open the floor.
Madness. Future historians are going to look back
at what... Stop exploding to women of color!
right, yeah, get him the hell out of here, will you please?
Wake up.
What do you
we
want?
We gotta stop listening to this rhetoric that's in the media.
Michelle, what do you people want?
What do I want?
Michelle.
When you say you people, what do you mean?
The complaining black people, blaming others for the failure of their parents and their lives.
What complaining?
Blaming others for whatever it is you complain about. What is it exactly do you want from white people?
First of all, I'm just going to take a breath. And
I'm trying to find out what you want.
What's your nationality?
American.
Are you white?
I'm black American.
Oh, okay.
What do you want?
Caucasian.
Oh, you do? And but, why do you think that? Why do you think that?
Because you seem to separate yourself from us, should I say.
In
put
what
us
way?
On the other side of the
way?
Fence. In the ways that you've specified thus far.
Meaning what? Tell me, give me an example and tell me what you mean.
You how you mean, how do, what do you people want from white people? Meaning
people,
that I'm not with
yourself.
You.
Oh, okay,
it's
I got
just
you.
Y'all by yourself,
let
right?
Let me explain why I do that. What you don't know is that there are two realities in life.
Mm-hmm.
One is that of good and one is that of evil. And now that I've been able to overcome evil, I don't identify with angry, evil black people. I identify with other blacks and others who are on the side of good. And so that's why I say you people, because I have to divide myself or separate myself from evil and go along with good. So that's why I do that.
What is it that makes us evil?
I'm sorry, your anger, your blaming others for your problems, your lack of love and respect for yourself and others.
Okay.
Sir, the court believes you represent a danger to the community. This appears not to be an isolated incident. The court notes the strength of the case against you. The court also notes that a police officer had a shot taken from him, most likely from the vehicle you were in, where there were two guns found, where shortly thereafter you bailed out of that car. And
Your Honor,
they,
I
don't
read
interrupt
the
me, sir. Sir, don't interrupt
me.
Dale, wait
up. Hold on,
Dale.
Hold on, Dale.
And they found you with a gun holster on, hiding in water under someone's dock. Yes, the court does believe you represent a danger not only to the people of the community who own homes, who own vehicles, but the court also notes that a police officer had a shot taken at him. So, anything you want to add, Mr. Miller?
Yeah, my reading of the probable cause affidavit never places Mr. Clark inside the car.
Okay. Running from the area where the car was. And
but,
the co-defendant Wesley admits that Clark was there with everyone else to burglarize the vehicles in the area.
So, okay, so the guns are found in the car. Mr. Clark is never connected with the car. Again, how are we connecting him with the shot being fired?
Sir, I'm going to say your bond.
Shots are being fired, and he's running from the scene because shots are being fired.
Right, this, right. And he's got
in
a holster.
In light of what's
and
happening
he's got a holster
in
on.
Never had a holster.
Got it.
Your Honor,
sir,
in light of what's happening in this country, with unarmed black men being killed by police.
Don't hand me that. Don't even go down that road. I'm not going to let you go down that road. That is so off base. We've got a young man. I don't care what color he is. He's in a neighborhood he doesn't live in at 1:41 in the morning, hiding on someone under somebody's dock in the water with a holster on after a police officer had a shot taken at him. Don't hand me this. He's a black man running from police brutality. Look, that is not appropriate in this case. That's not there. I'm not going to let you poison this case with bringing in something that has nothing to do with it. Your bond's $100,000 on count three and $100,000 on count four. Thank you. Now, Donnie Heath, I got to take a break. I'll be right back.
If you are in this religion, you probably do have values that are at odds. This is what liberals don't want to recognize. You may be from a country, as there are many, many Muslim countries that either have Sharia law or want Sharia law. Those values are not our values.
I actually strongly disagree with that, Bill. I think that it is incredibly important, particularly now after the Paris attacks, particularly now with ISIL raging around the world, to stand up for real diversity and to say our diversity is our strength.
So keeping women as second-class citizens is just diversity?
No, I'm not saying that.
But you are saying that. That's what it comes down to.
No, I'm not. What I'm saying is we in Canada are not going to say Muslims are worse than Christians or are worse than Jews or are worse than atheists.
Not as people. The ideas are worse.
No, and their culture is not worse. And we also appreciate that ISIL does not represent Muslims, and it's now more important than ever to say that and to stand up for diversity. I mean, it is very, very wrong to demonize a religion. But
I'm not demonizing. I'm just reporting. You are making it a demonization.
But you don't do it by saying to them Muslims are bad.
But you're not saying Muslims are bad.
Right.
You are saying that.
We're saying the ideas need to be changed.
You're saying their ideas are bad?
Killing women for being raped, I would say, is a bad idea.
We need to kill all men. The only answer to that is to kill male babies.
When I saw the title, I thought it was a satirical article or something making fun of modern-day feminists. That's what I immediately thought by looking at the title, because it seemed very sarcastic. But I was quickly reminded that modern-day feminists and their SJW brethren have been operating under Poe's law for many years now, meaning that it is impossible to tell when someone is trolling or satirizing them and whenever it's the real thing. So the title of the article reads as follows. I don't care that you land a probe on a comment, your shirt is sexist and ostracizing. Now, just reading this title, I'm sure you can probably imagine what kind of rhetoric it consists of in the article. In a nutshell, the two authors of this article, a man and a woman, find it deeply offensive and problematic, as the word they like to use, that one of the lead scientists on this project decided to wear a bowling shirt that had moderately scantily clad women embroidering it. Yes, this is what they got outraged over. On this day of monumental scientific achievement, this is what feminists decided to hone in on. And that should tell you a lot about their worldview and the way their minds work. And also keep in mind that the man who wrote most of this article is the co-founder of Polygon. So yeah, that's not really much of a shock. So first of all, I would like to point out how ironic it is that feminists want to attack and defame a man for his clothing, and yet if you were to criticize a woman's clothing for any reason whatsoever, feminists would proverbially burn you at the stake.
You know that less than 10% of rapes are actually reported.
Okay, where's that?
To the cops.
From? Where's that?
It's from all of the women's organizations. You can look it up online. You can find it through the socialized organizations that study rape. I participate with an organization that works as a rape crisis center. We base that on the number of calls. The police know based on the unofficial reports, the third-party reporting, and the direct reports. This is not a secret that about 10% of rapes are reported.
So how do you know 10% of rapes are reported if the others aren't?
Because those people call the women's centers, they ask for help, they seek medical attention.
So they are reported.
The 12 weeks. It does not look like that. It's a clump of motherfucking cells. No hands are shown for that time. It's just a white fucking privileged racist fucking male that doesn't stand for women's rights.
Get the fuck out of here. Fuck dipshit. And get that camera out of my face. See ya. Fuckwit.
I'm gonna call the police.
Fuck you.
Will, Riley! 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 Hold on a second.
Fuck witch!
We are calling the police, ma'am.
You are fucking white male privileged assholes!
I'm calling the police right now.
What you are is a racist motherfucker as well! How dare you fucking do this kind of shit, asshole!
You're being videotaped. We will return this to the police.
This is what white people are. They're fucking aliens. They're fucking parasites.
But let me say this. Black people cannot be racist.
They're fucking soulless.
Knowing who Jordan was, I believe he would want me to offer forgiveness. Although I know I may struggle with that endeavor for the rest of my life, it would be what Jordan would want. On behalf of Jordan and myself, I will pray for forgiveness for both of you.
And no matter what sentence the court imposes today, these defendants will have to answer to God. God's got this.
I'd like to say sorry to the families of Ayanna Jones, Michael Brown, Eric Gardner, and I want to apologize to them for not being able to get justice for their loved ones who was murdered in cold blood. And in respect for the peaceful protest, I want to say hands up, don't shoot, Black Lives Matter. That's it, Toronto.
Very familiar.
It's not about the chromosomes within our nuclei.
We both know chromosomes don't necessarily mean you're male or female.
Gender.
With gender
identity. Go ahead. No, so
especially, but even so, you have a thing like Klinefelter's syndrome. So you don't know what you're talking about. You're not educated on genetics.
Would you like to discuss the genetics?
Your
genetics?
I'd stay away from the genetics and back to the brain scans.
You cut that out now, or you'll go home in an ambulance.
Yeah, that seems mildly inappropriate for a political discussion.
No, I know. Well, yep. But to be fair, you're actually being rude.
You're horrible.
No, that's not fair.
I'm sorry. It's not rude to say that someone who is biologically a male is a male.
You just
someone who is
sir.
Biologically male is a male.
There it was. There I was thinking it was just me that had a problem, but it turns out it's the air conditioning that's sexist.
I know. So many women in our office have the exact same problem. You know, we just sit there absolutely freezing at our desks trying to type. You can probably tell I've got a cold right now, which I blame all on the AC. And so it's just so actually quite nice to see this research. It's just such a relief to know that there's actually proof that this is happening, that women, you know, do feel the cold more than men, and that the AC in offices is normally regulated more for a male's temperature than a woman's. One of the biggest problems is that often in offices, it is men who control temperatures. You know, that's just something I've found anecdotally. And because majority of the men in offices seem to be absolutely fine with the temperatures, you know, women kind of just sit there on the corner feeling absolutely frozen. And, you know, often like actually nothing's being done to help them. And, you know, it might sound like a bit of a silly, lighthearted issue, but actually it's really uncomfortable being freezing at your desk every day. Take it from me.
If people like you were put in prison as retaliation for the collective crime of racism, anti-Semitism, misogyny, and homophobia. All you fucking God botherers are war criminals and liars and charlatans. Atheism forever!
Is this a deathbed tryout?
No, this is real. I'm throwing back everything you dirty Gorham have thrown back at us. Hitler was a Christian! He killed Jews because his fucking because his non-existent God told him to! Hitler was a practicing Catholic! Now I even found on the internet a picture of a Nazi swastika. It was made by the Nazis and it had a cross on it. It said, God is with us, in German. Yeah, so don't give me that whole crap about Nazi. You know what? Atheism is apolitical. Stalin was an atheist, but you know who else was an atheist? Ayn Rand. So atheism has got nothing to do with politics, but only about the facts. And the fact is, you look up in the sky, and you know what you see? Sky, clouds, and the sun.
What we are saying is move the hell over. Other people deserve that platform. Other people who are not white, who are not men, and who are not of the people that you call privileged. Yeah, go for it.
Is it not true that to have a different opinion isn't the same as telling other people that you shouldn't have or that you can't have that opinion?
In your opinion, what's the
the cure to our westernized kind of idea that it's okay to catcall at women and that sort of thing. What is the solution in your opinion?
What is the solution to catcalling? Certainly not walking around in my underwear.
Are you a bigot towards conservatives?
No, I'm not a bigot towards conservatives. Okay, I think if anyone's a bigot, no offense, but I think all of you are the bigots. You're all the white cis male bigots. You know, and you're attacking people that are, in your opinion, lower than you.
Like Michael, I want you to get laid, okay? I can tell you don't get laid a lot. When you do all this white knight shit, it turns pussies dry.
If you ever, white knight, okay?
First, if you want to get laid, you got to grow balls. When you do this fucking faggot shit, women don't want to fuck you. Even the biggest feminists, their boyfriends are fucking bikers. You need to grow your hair long, get a leather vest, and sit on a fucking crotch rocket.
I'm proud to be a social justice warrior, okay? Everyone keeps calling me that in the comments. And
no one is gonna fuck you, ever!
What?
Do you know how dry pussies get when you say social justice warrior?
You've restarted, fair enough.
Let me just stop you so you don't waste a line of questioning. I'm just giving you...
I love the mansplaining. I'm enjoying it.
You're loving what?
The mansplaining that's going on.
What's... What
well, just
mean?
Talking me through how... not answering the question
by
repeating processes which are not related to the question that I've asked.
What's mansplaining, Senator?
Well, it's the slightly patronising and condescending way that you're responding to my questions.
Well, I would suggest, Senator, that if you're putting the word man in front of some description of what I'm doing, you're doing that which I'm sure you're very much against, is making a sexist implication about how I'm conducting my role as a man.
Well, then the easiest way to do it...
Is that what you're saying, Senator?
Well, what I'm saying is that the way you've been responding to me has been patronising and condescending, and I have responded to that. So the easiest way to deal with this is not to have that way in responding to the questions I've asked.
Imagine the reaction, Senator, if I said you were woman-splaining. You're saying that I'm mansplaining.
Well, it is a term that's used.
Is it
when,
by whom?
By rude senators.
By senators who are seeking to make gender an issue. Stop being a hypocrite.
Well,
conduct yourself appropriately for this place.
I'm sorry you're so offended by the use of the word. It is a word that's used. I'm surprised that you're so shocked by the use of the word.
No, I'm just calling hypocrisy. Hypocrisy, thy name is Labor. Thy name is Senator Gallagher.
Hey guys, so today we're going to protest at a university for fun.
And as you can tell by our signs here and our fedoras, we're obviously 100% serious.
Are you fucking kidding me?
No!
Feminists are sexist!
All feminists are sexist!
All women are sexist!
I coined the term womanist. Females, those guys trying to diss. I am a true feminist. I am Alice Walker.
You and me have equal pay. I fight for it every day. This was the second wave, and now we're on our way.
Owning property.
Women educated.
Freedom from domestic violence.
And the right to vote, baby.
Hey, I just met you.
The students then made a video attempting to justify their actions, but once again failed, with the video having over 4,000 dislikes before it reached one single like.
Single women in general are making less than men.
Here's another thing that's never occurred to you. Have you ever considered the possibility that Mima is lazy?
No, she's not lazy. She actually worked a day job, a night job, and a weekend job.
What's she doing right now, though, besides sitting on her ass making sweet tea for a fucking beta male ginger sphere?
Meanwhile, got 5 hours of sleep a night for 30 years. We got 4 or 5 hours of sleep. She raised 3 children on her own because my grandpa was a deadbeat loser.
Yeah, well, that's the tragedy here is the lack of men in the family. And I'll take your hit with Meemaw's hard work. I'll assume you're not lying. But for the most part, single moms are lazy. And it's a really shitty thing to do to a kid.
What?
Become a single mom knowingly. Most single moms are single moms by choice. And look what they create.
My grandpa
look at
was
you.
A terrible person. He was also...
Look in the mirror. Grow a fucking beard and wear a camel hat. You're in Georgia.
First of all, I have a beard, okay?
No, a beard. Not a gorilla mask. All right, bye. I've had enough of you.
Yeah, peace, asshole.
Fuck you.
Fuck you.
Grow jerk. A fucking nut.
In the variations of a market economy, but
Mark,
2%
you and
is
your
nothing
statistics,
compared
you know,
to 200%.
You're narrowing it to university graduates there in order to get a statistic which is not borne out by the greater society.
Yeah, but
no,
in your
is
statistics, they're women who are choosing to work fewer hours, Andrew. You're just playing
wrong.
I don't
think what? That's always the
right. We need to go back over this statistical analysis again. Do you want,
aside but, from the statistics, let's...
Wow, a feminist that doesn't like to use statistics. Who could have seen that coming?
So let's look at the notion that women over the past 40 years, we are better educated, which means we have more financial freedom. We don't need a man like we may have needed a couple of decades ago. Do you think there's any truth to the argument that perhaps men feel sort of threatened because they no longer have that power in the, or do you think there's any?
No, I think the average man's doing quite fine. They ignore most of the left feminist claptrap. They ignore people like Van.
Gotcha, bitch.
Who are a very, very minority interest in our society. She's a self-declared anarchist, way, way on the extreme left of politics, representing perhaps 0.001% of thought in Australia. So she's safely ignored. The real issue for men is, can they keep up in the education system at the moment? Among university graduates leaving every year, 40% are male, 60% are female, a massive advance for women in this country. And when you look at the bottom of society, when you get away from Van's debate about women like her, because left feminism is essentially selfish.
Shots fired! Shots fired!
Can I hear? Can I speak, Andrew, without you being a participant? Are you a participant in this show or a host? Are you a professional host or a participant?
I'm trying to get to the bottom of the issue, but you try to insult the other guests.
Are you the host of this program, professional and cool?
Are
you
a participant?
You should declare what you're doing at the beginning of the segment. You should declare your interest at the beginning of the segment. Because I can tell you the viewers had a gutful of you having a bet each way.
Why don't we try
Which
and keep away from
point,
personal attacks?
Can
I defend myself, please?
Shut the fuck up, you'll speak when fucking spoken to. XDDDDD.
Self, please, or is a man going to speak over me?
Oh, you're trying to speak over us.
Yes, you are speaking over me, Mark.
Here we go.
Feminism is cancer and I'm triggered.
Now, I've known you for 20 years.
No, you haven't.
I'm a stupid cunt.
I met you when I was an undergraduate at the University of Wollongong.
Well,
you know for a fact I'm from a working class family from the suburbs of Sydney. And I write about that in my work all the time. You have to deal with the fact, Mark, that your position is the extremist one. I'm from the suburbs. I'm state school. I'm University of Wollongong. And I'm a feminist commentator who has pointed out the fact that women are discriminated against in this society. Let's talk about those trains and the need for safe carriages.
Van, can you just give us a moment?
On a train when you were a teenager? Because I was.
Excuse me, Van. I mean with respect to all of you, but I think
feminism is cancer.
At this stage,
I caught the train about 20 years ago. The practicality on the 11:30
Mark,
train.
Good on you with your personal attacks. Good on you, mate. Good to see you sticking to the topic again.
Well, I am sticking to the topic. It just shows how little you know about the practicalities of life in the suburbs. Because the idea
because
that
I don't live in a suburb. I live in a cloud. Mark.
No, you live in cloud cuckoo land. Absolutely. So look, the point is that if you're on the 11:30 train out of the city and there's a women's only carriage and you're a bad bloke who wants to do damage. Well, you go straight in.
So there was this like everybody like saw the like feminism is cancer thing on like in the library and got torn down and stuff, right? Like
whoever did that deserves a slap on the bottom. Horrible behavior.
Oh my goodness. It's funny. And then like I saw the news was about Breitbart, so they had this video and it was like, would you rather have your child be a feminist or have cancer? And it's like, whoa.
Yeah, the students at Michigan did that, it was funny.
Yeah. So and they like promoted it. But it's funny, so my freshman year of high school, I was diagnosed with cancer.
Yes.
And I had Hodgkin's lymphoma. I had stage 4 cancer like from my neck down to like my pelvis. So like that's where all the tumors were. But like I'm also, and I hate to break it to you, I'm a feminist too. So like would you tell my parents like when I was diagnosed and like almost about to die? Would you be like, I'm so sorry that you also believe in like equality of the sexes? Like that's so
I would quote my favorite rapper and I would say, if you can take a dick, you can take a joke.
Oh wait.
talk about law school, and I think it's interesting to note because I think we're both feminists.
I never considered myself a feminist. All during my professional career, whether it be a lawyer or a judge, I never belonged to a woman's organization. I didn't want to be, I wasn't a woman lawyer. I was a lawyer who happened to be a woman, and I wasn't a woman judge. I was a judge who happened to be a woman. I actually never felt, probably I was too stupid to know that I was held back at any time because of my gender. And I still don't. I still don't feel as if there was any time in my life when I thought that being a woman held me back. You define yourself. If you let other people define you, that's a mistake.
Because I think we're both feminists.
Studies that are coming out now, Cornell, 2015, women going into STEM subjects have a 2-to-1 advantage over men going for the same jobs. Fewer women do apply, but they all get the jobs.
You've got to have the degree, you've got to have done STEM, you've got to have the A-level, the GCSE, and then the degree.
Yes, and when women choose to do that, they have a 2-to-1 advantage over men in the workplace, and they get paid better.
When they choose to do it, yes. But you have to decide, in England, you have to choose at 15 if you're going to do sciences or not. And at 15, women and girls aren't encouraged to do so. So yes, they're more likely to, but the amount of them doing it is vanishing, well, not vanishing, rare, quite rare.
Again, you have to explain, if you believe that the number of women in STEM subjects is too low because women are not being encouraged to do science subjects, there aren't enough women in physics and maths and philosophy, you have to explain why women dominate biology. Why women dominate medicine.
Because of the girly sciences.
What does that mean?
The sciences that are more linked to caring professions.
I don't think you should make generalisations like that. Some people find that kind of offensive.
So that clearly shows that she doesn't like...
Well, I never said she was consistent, but she... she did write an article in the wake of the Charlotte Proudman issue, and there was a lawyer who decided she didn't want to be a lawyer anymore, she wanted to be a Guardian columnist, so she made a name for herself by complaining that a man had said she looked nice. Well, I'm sorry, love. So she went to town, publicly shamed him.
I suspect this is verging the runs of ad hominem attacks.
I am really interested to hear where you're going, though, because I don't think I read
it. In your piece, you said that if it was a man, you'd probably have laughed. Do you want me to quote it?
I'm genuinely, yes, I would, because I'm not saying you're wrong, I just don't remember writing it.
Okay. I'll find it while you're recording.
I'll just one last question, just to clarify.
Yeah, it was, if I knew that a male member of staff was speculating about how I look naked, I would cause the sort of fuss that would make Charlotte Proudman look meek. If I heard a female colleague doing the same thing about Andrew in accounts, I'd probably laugh and I might even join in.
And I can...
When you walk into a room and mostly everybody's white, privilege! When you make out with your partner and it's totally alright, privilege! When you need a pill and you don't get no shit from the far right, privilege! Oh, privilege! We've learned to ignore it. Our invisible knapsack is where we store it, privilege.
Liberals need to stand up for liberal principles. This is what I said on last week's show. Obviously, I got a lot of hate for it, but all I'm saying is that liberal principles like freedom of speech, freedom to practice any religion you want without fear of violence, freedom to leave a religion, equality for women, equality for minorities, including homosexuals. These are liberal principles that liberals applaud for. But then when you say in the Muslim world, this is what's lacking, then they get upset.
Yeah, even it gets.
So hold on, are you the person who understands the officially codified doctrine of Islam? You're the interpreter
I'm actually well educated on this topic.
I'm asking you. So you're saying if I criticize the, you're saying that Islamophobia is not a real thing.
I'm not denying that certain people are bigoted against Muslims as people. That's a problem.
Big of you.
But why are you so hostile about this? It's gross. It's racist.
It's like saying you're a shifty Jew.
You're not listening to what we are saying.
You guys are saying, if you want to be liberals, believe in liberal principles like freedom of speech, we are endowed by our forefathers with inalienable rights, like all men are created equal.
Ben, we have to be able to criticize bad ideas. And
of course we do. No liberal doesn't want to criticize bad ideas.
But Islam is the mother load of bad ideas.
Jesus.
So we have ideas like blasphemy.
It is an ugly
apostasy.
It is gross. It's racist.
It's
As more details come out about the sexual and physical assaults during New Year's celebrations in Germany and other parts of Europe, we find that some of the suspects are in fact asylum seekers. And
I want to show you something. It's my shocked face.
Sexual assault and rape. You know, I'm not a sociologist, so I don't know. All I know, it's pretty prevalent in all societies, right? I mean, look at the Catholic Church. Right. Look at that. What happened? Just raping kids and covering up and to at the very top. And these aren't just morons on a street on New Year's Eve. Right. So. In fact, the Kaiser Foundation said that they did a survey. 1 in 5 women will be raped or attempted raped while they're in college.
Right. Oh, it's an epidemic on college campus.
So all of a sudden we go, but we have a big rape culture problem here in the United States, right? What? So I don't know enough about their culture to push back, but I do know about my culture.
Yeah. So look, I don't think that their culture is rapey, but I think it's
right because it's more
indisputable. Yeah, it's
this story is so frustrating because I think we all know, and Anna, what you were saying is that it's going to be used as a cudgel to sort of like beat the same old drum of racism and bigotry
yeah.
about the people from the Middle East that are these refugees and talk about what their cultures say or don't say. And you know,
Michel Platini, Jurgen Klinsmann, Didier Deschamps, Iker Casillas, and now a topless feminist has lifted the European Cup. Jana, an activist in the feminist group Femin, peeled down her top, revealing the words, Flip Euro 2012. Well, something like that. She then tried to pinch the famous trophy. Luckily, security forces were on hand and couldn't have been quicker to surround her, scuppering her plans. Femin believes Euro 2012, which will run in Ukraine from June 9th to July 1st, will lead to a surge in prostitution in the former Soviet Republic and entrench the country as a sex tourist destination in Europe. The group is planning to carry out a series of stunts during the tournament.
Feminist Femin topless protester Turkey Belarus president were bear hugged by police. Three radical Femin protesters were bear hugged and arrested in the Ukraine after holding a topless protest against the visit of President Lukashenko of Belarus. In Kiev, they tried to wake up the president up at night outside the building where he was staying, calling him the last dictator of Europe and accusing his government of repression. The protesters removed their tops to expose statements such as "Dictator, get out!" Detector across their chests and backs. Security officials hold them away. Femin claims that in December 2011, its activists were kidnapped and roughed up by the Belarusian security service, who led them in a forest near the Belarus-Ukraine border.
No, 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 no,
I want you to like cover up. You can put your son in protest all you want. Just cover up. I mean, if there was no kids here, then it wouldn't be a problem.
You have to get a degree in college.
Stop touching me!
Stop getting in the doorway. Excuse me, guys.
Oh,
kind of crazy.
Oh yeah.
Wait, you were trying to block people, but now you're coming through.
I didn't say I was blocking anyone.
Do not touch
them out. I don't know.
I'm going to walk in front of someone and then tell them not to touch me. That makes about as much sense.
Dude, are you guys racist? You're not letting in African-Americans into the speech?
One looks like a Nazi.
Shots fired! Shots fired!
They're all I'm a Nazi. Fucking Nazi? I'm a fucking Jew, man.
But
so
you
please
look
don't
like,
call
you
me
look
a Nazi.
Like a motherfucking Nazi.
Oh, because I shaved my fucking head, man! Because I shaved my fucking head, I'm a Nazi!
Relax.
And being, I do not stand with this!
We should film. Oh. Yeah. Oh, no.
Pretty. Pretty.
Pretty.
What the fuck? I'm not the pretty fucking helpless princess in distress. I'm pretty fucking powerful
and ready for success.
So what is more offensive?
A little girl saying fuck or the fucking unequal and sexist.
It's time to stop! It's time to stop, okay? No more! Where the fuck are your parents? Who are your parents? I'm gonna call Child Protective Services. It's time to stop!
Society treats girls and women.
The continued sexism, girls and women's stale face.
Instead of cleaning these girls' mouths out with soap, maybe society should clean up its act. This is what a feminist looks like.
You touched me, and you're about to.
Now it's the breath.
That poor old man just got punched and he can't hit back because she's a girl. Oh wait, I forgot she wants gender equality.
Gotcha, bitch!
And I'm extra nice, you know, extra gentleman. I'm extra just like, oh, you're beautiful and you deserve the best. And she told me I was too nice. I couldn't believe it. It wouldn't work because I was too nice. That was the ultimate stab in the back.
Stop giving these bitches all the attention. So you need to start checking these bitches. We gotta start saying fuck these bitches, man. If you fucking with a cool female, that's all good. But if you fucking with a bitch, you need to break her ass and shake her ass. Break her ass and shake her ass. Break her ass and shake her ass.
Pink. He loves pink. And like his favorite dress is the black one with pink flamingos on it.
You could be forgiven for mistaking this toddler for a little girl, but 2-year-old Max Price is actually a boy. Max's parents are raising him gender neutral.
So what happens when you say alleged rape and rape actually does happen? What are we doing when we treat women like that?
I don't understand.
You can't put someone in prison if you haven't proven them guilty of something.
So then how do we prove everyone guilty of stuff? There are convictions, there are charges. When you say alleged rape, you're not believing the victim of said rape. You know, we put alleged as a word.
So are you saying that we should just believe women right away when they say they've been raped?
We have to believe any rape victim.
Joining us now is someone who is protesting outside the Ferguson Police Department when those two officers were shot last night. Ivory Nett is with us. Ivory, there's a couple of, I've talked to a lot of people on the ground, including people that were there last night. And there's two different stories that have emerged. One is that the shot came from behind the crowd, which brings up the issue of whether or not a high-powered rifle with a scope was used. And others say, well, no, maybe it came from the crowd. What can you tell us?
I was basically right there at the crowd, so I can definitely say it did not come from the crowd. But this is what you have here. There's a situation that happened back in August when Mike Brown was killed, and that was the first action that happened. Then you have a reaction what happened, which was last night when the police officers got shot. I'm not saying it was right.
Ivory, no, you should be saying it's wrong, because, you know, we now have the Department of Justice under Eric Holder. We now have the grand jury. We have eyewitnesses, many who happen to be black. They testified to the fact that, and the evidence showed and the forensics showed, we have Mike Brown robbing a store, intimidating a clerk. We know he fought for a cop's gun. We know he charged at a police officer. So you're acting as though this is, well, to be expected after Mike Brown acted the way he acted. I think the story here is you shouldn't act that way and people shouldn't be shooting cops. I don't hear you saying that. Why not?
The thing is, you have no evidence that he charged anybody in the store.
We have witnesses that testify.
Okay. There are also witnesses that testify Mike Brown had his hands up. So you look at the facts first. And the fact remains is there was an altercation on Canfield. The altercation happened between Darren Wilson and Mike Brown. Mike Brown, with the forensics show, there were bullets with the hands. I don't know how, I'm not a scientist, but the facts remain. But with the cops getting shot last night, that was not right. But that was not right for Mike Brown to be dead. 4 hours left, 4 hours on the ground.
But so, you know, so there's an action and there's a reaction. Let me ask you this. Let me read to you, I'm sure you didn't read the 87-page report from Eric Holder's Justice Department, did you?
I haven't, but in
life. You haven't. Let me help you, and I'm going to read some of it for you and some of it for our audience, because this is what Eric Holder's Justice Department found out. Witness accounts suggesting that Brown was standing still with his hands raised in an unambiguous signal of surrender when Wilson shot Brown are inconsistent with the physical evidence, are otherwise not credible because of the internal inconsistencies, or are not credible because of inconsistencies with other credible evidence. In contrast, Officer Wilson's account of Brown's actions, if true, would establish that the shootings were not objectively unreasonable under the relevant constitutional standards governing an officer's use of deadly force. Multiple credible witnesses corroborate virtually every material aspect of Wilson's account and are consistent with the physical evidence. Let me translate that for you. So Eric Holder's Justice Department, after investigating it all these months, said the witnesses corroborated and the forensics corroborated and the evidence corroborated the officer's story, and you still believe otherwise. Why don't you believe Eric Holder's Justice Department?
Sir, it sounds like your head is a one-way street, so I'm going to take you to Canfield. I'm going to take you to the St. Louis community, how we feel about this.
So you don't care what the facts are. You don't care what the evidence says.
No. The fact remains is Mike Brown was laid down on that ground for 4 hours.
You keep repeating yourself, but the evidence is that the witnesses said
because that was a fact. That was a fact. That was a fact, sir. So you have to listen to the fact.
All right, here's a fact. Did he rob a store?
Before you,
did Michael Brown rob a store, sir? He did. Did he intimidate a clerk? He did. Did he fight a cop for his gun? He did. Did he charge an officer? According to the Justice Department, he did.
How do you know? How do you
know? Because of witnesses and forensic evidence presented in the case that you obviously didn't read. And now two cops are shot, and you're trying to compare this.
We're on live TV right now, so present that to the world. Can you do that? Can you present that to the world?
You need to educate yourself and maybe read the evidence in the case.
No,
read
no.
the grand
put
jury
the facts,
testimony,
put the facts
which you
on,
haven't read,
put the facts
and read
on
the
television.
Department of Justice
put
report.
Put the facts on television.
Now, let me go back to Steve Harrigan.
So confident am I, you know, that they are the most intellectually lazy people on the planet. I wrote them a guide on how to beat me. I tweet it every week. And this lovely inversion that I'm seeing happen, which I love so much, this lovely inversion of what the left has done to us for so long, just shows how empty and platitudinous the crap they shut us down with is, you know?
That's right.
Feminists
something that you've actually heard
of. Derailing for Dummies, the author, people, everybody here. Where's the author? Derailing for Dummies.
A what?
Derailing for Dummies. Because he doesn't like to actually stay on point, he likes to derail. Okay,
I asked where, you made a statement, I said, where's it on our website? I asked a question, you made a statement, I asked a question.
This is what we're talking about. In general, like, I'm not talking
dogs that need to be trained, that need to be put on a leash.
Well, public if she says public.
We don't accept this. You know what? We
I don't give a shit if that's actually listed on you, your
but it's not women's so fault. It's not feminist fault.
Then why are you making the allegation?
To borrow a phrase, you just use the proof is in the pudding.
So, and this is what, this is the message that we have gotten from Emory. So if that's the message that you actually have gotten from feminists, that we expect you to pay alimony, or that we expect you to lose custody of your children, then listen the fuck up and understand what we're actually about. Because it's not what those things are.
Right? What they'll say is, well, it costs too much money. But, you know what? It would cost about the same as what we would spend it, over the course of 10 years. It would cost what it would cost us. All right. Okay. We're going to. It would cost us about the same as it would cost for about... Hold on one second. I can't hear myself.
Think that you're so slick. Let me emasculate you. Because your precious dick can't be my vibrator. We're feeling the frustration from all the exploitation. Prepare for your castration. So we can fuck this man's world. With all its bullshit, girls don't deserve it.
Here to see what's going on with the young people. Oh, you got kicked out too.
Let me recap on you.
No. You know what? This happened yesterday. I actually put a video up about the same thing.
Yeah. You're in our space.
Your safe space?
Gotcha, bitch!
Do you have puppies or kittens in your safe space?
Both.
Yeah, see, that's the correct answer. Both.
You're in our space.
Your safe space?
Gotcha, bitch!
As a feminist, I just want to tear down every poster, destroy and burn every toy, and skip past every trailer that is before my YouTube videos. Mine.
You got mail. Our terror is not for sale.
Go back to the fucking commune, you hippies.
Shut up, you fucking idiot.
Shut up, you grape-looking slut. Look at you, you fat bitch.
Kelly Mullen, a million student march national event organizer. Kelly, good to have you. Keeley, I'm sorry. Is it Keeley or Kelly?
That's okay. It's Keeley.
I apologize. So what do you
totally
want
fine.
Here? What do you want?
So the movement, the Million Student March, is a movement for a more equitable and fair system of education, as opposed to the really corporate model that we have right now. So the three core demands of the National Day of Action are free public college, a cancellation of student debt, and a $15 an hour minimum wage for people who work on the campus.
And how's that going to be paid?
Great question. I'm not sure if you're talking on like a national level or at particular schools. I can sort of touch on both. At
well,
my
if you
university,
wanted all
Northeastern
that
university,
stuff, someone asked to pick up the tab. Who would that be?
The 1% of people in society that are hoarding the wealth and really sort of causing a catastrophe that students are facing. I mean, we have a relationship right now where 1% of the population owns more wealth than the 99% combined.
All right, so if the 1%, Keeley, if the 1% just had their taxes raised a few years ago back to almost 40%, then to pay for the health care law, they had them raised another few percentage points. Then they had their deductions limited to raise another couple points where, depending on the state or locality, they're pushing over about 50% in taxes. How much higher do you think? How much more do you think they should pay?
I think enough until we have a system where not one in two American families are threatened with poverty.
So where do they go? Let's say if you tax them, they're smart folks, these people, these 1% hoarders, right? So if they leave here,
yeah.
Then who's going to pay for all this stuff that you want?
If they leave?
The country.
Oh, I mean, there's always going to be a 1% in the U.S. The U.S. is like the bastion of capitalism and its success, and I think
Do you think the 1% can pay for all of this?
Absolutely. 85 people in the world hold more wealth than half of the global population.
No, wait a minute. I mean, are we talking about 85 billionaires, or are you extending this to the 1%? Or whomever who earn a little bit north of $250,000. At what level, Keeley, do you start saying you got to pay a hell of a lot more than you're paying now in taxes?
I mean, I think people earning, certainly people earning over $1 million a year should be contributing to the wellness of society.
If it's 50% now, let's say it's around 50% with taxes. We used to have a top rate of 90%. You think we should get back to that?
I mean, I think that eventually we will get back to that. I think
and
eventually.
You're okay with that? Are some of your friends okay with that? Do some of them want to be successful themselves and they'd be happy when they get to a level, maybe over 200,000, 250,000, they start paying 90% in taxes on that? They'll be happy with that?
Absolutely. I mean, I think that.
Keeley,
people,
come on. You're talking to me here. Your friends are going to be happy getting to a point in their career when they can look outside and say, finally, I'm able to pay 90% in taxes.
Obviously, you know, people in your position, you know, don't want to pay 90% in taxes.
I dare say, unless you're high as a kite, you wouldn't volunteer to pay 90%, right? I mean, unless you really did see a considerable bang for the buck and it was worth it, right? But a lot of the times that you realize it's not worth it, and given some of the track records we've seen with government, it doesn't always work, right?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. But the reality is we have to look at the injustice of the system as it exists right now.
Then
do you think if
everyone paid a little bit more for this, would you pay a little bit more for this, besides the rich, that to pay for that it's worth it? That do you think these are good goals?
People already are paying for
I asked it differently. I asked you, would you, Keeley, and your friends, and your mom, and your dad, and your family, would they happily pay more to provide all of these benefits you just outlined?
Of course, and we already are.
You just said to pay for some of the things you wanted, the rich should pay significantly more than they're paying right now. Now you're telling me.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying.
Okay,
Everyone's already paying.
Well, they're not. I mean, now you're saying these added benefits that you want, and they're fine benefits, don't get me wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You think your friends, their parents, your family would be happy to pay a little bit more to provide these guarantees and benefits?
I come from an incredibly working class family, and my family is already on numerous forms of government assistance and is basically scraping by, you know, in order to get me through college. I live in a world and I see a system around me where there's a population that's doing nothing to contribute to the progression of society. Education is really the only way that we have innovation, that
I'm sure you sound very smart. You know what's going on. You mentioned what's going on in the world. You're probably aware of what's happening in Greece and these other countries that provided all these benefits and then some, many of which you outlined very nicely here for us today. And they're going broke and they're out of money. And they don't know what to do. And their people are riding on the streets because they can't believe the money's gone. And the benefits and the promises are gone.
Right.
What do you think?
I mean, there's a global catastrophe right now of complete defunding of social services.
Because they ran out of money.
You know
what happened, Keeley? They just ran out of money.
Yeah.
Right?
I understand, but there is a 1% in Greece. There's a 1% in the United States. There's a 1%. There's a ruling class in absolutely every...
I don't doubt there is, Keeley. I don't doubt there is, but obviously they've been trying to tap them to get money from, and they realize either they don't have the money or they hid from the money. They're gone. They're gone.
Yeah.
And now these countries are going
bust.
Yeah, so
those people need to be accountable.
All right, fine, but they're smart and they're scaring all over the globe. So now even
yeah,
if
they
you
are, and that's a problem.
All right, but they've done studies on this, kid. I don't want to get boring here. But even if you were to take the 1% and take all of their money, tax it 100%, do you know that couldn't keep Medicare, just Medicare in this country, going for 3 years? Did you know that?
If we're to a point where the rich is paying 100% on their taxes, then we're on the road to socialism and we're going to have a completely different type of public infrastructure.
No, no, what I told you is that even if you took all the money from the rich who you say are getting away with murder, and you took it all away, it wouldn't support one entitlement in this country for 3 years.
I don't believe that. Okay. I'm sorry. I just don't. That sounds completely ludicrous to me.
Do you know how much it will cost to mandate a $15 minimum wage across the country, to have everyone's student loan debt paid off, to pay for public college for everyone?
How much?
Do you have a rough idea on the cost of just the educational part? On the student loan part and the public college.
Yeah, absolutely. $1.3 trillion in student debt. That's just a beginning. And then billions and billions of dollars.
Do you know how much you get fully taxing the 1%? 100%.
I don't know. Is it close to the number, the $16 trillion that we spent to bail out the banks in 2008?
Hear what I'm saying, because I just want this to be a math reminder. $1 trillion, which would barely keep Medicare going for 3 years. That's one area. Even if we repositioned it to go into this area that you want, we don't have enough to do it. So you're going to have to find other means of getting money, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think that that's a starting point. I mean, I think that all of these things require really comprehensive programs.
No doubt, no doubt. But do you fear, Keely? I guess what I'm asking you.
Yeah.
You're passionate about this, and I admire that passion and your involvement in this, but I think you have to step back and look at the numbers that could be involved here, because they're going to be huge.
Right.
And a lot of those, a college behind you and institutions behind you, knowing that student debt is taken care of, it's forgiven and done, do you think any of those guys, any of those administrators, any of those schools aren't going to leap at the opportunity to gouge even more, to raise tuitions even more, to raise room and board even more?
Well, I mean, ideally, if we have a big enough mass movement of people in the streets, we can actually prevent things like that from happening. I mean, that's one of the purposes.
All right. We'll see. We just lost her. I apologize for that. But history suggests that doesn't always happen.
If you've been successful, you didn't get there on your own. You didn't get there on your own. I'm always struck by people who think, well, it must be because I was just so smart. There are a lot of smart people out there. It must be because I worked harder than everybody else. Let me tell you something. There are a whole bunch of hard-working people out there. If you were successful, somebody along the line gave you some help. There was a great teacher somewhere in your life. Somebody helped to create this unbelievable American system that we had that allowed you to thrive. Somebody invested in roads and bridges. If you got a business, that you didn't build that. Somebody else made that happen. The internet didn't get invented on its own. Directed towards people who are already kind of understanding that gender is a social construct, but maybe aren't sold or haven't thought about the idea that biological sex is also a social construct.
Yeah, that's right. It's a good thing these pheasants have a society that can educate the males into their biological sex. Else, how would they, like, feel, you know, whatever, the social pressure to grow all that plumage? Because biological sex is just totally a social construct.
At age 46, after 23 years of marriage and 7 kids, Stephanie realized she wasn't a crossdresser. She was transgender, a person whose gender is different than the sex they were assigned at birth. These days, she's got a job plowing snow and has a new family made up of friends and a new relationship.
I'm allowed to be exactly who I am, and I don't have to apologize or make excuses why I'm different.
I can't deny I was married. I can't deny I have children. But I've moved forward now, and I've gone back to being a child. I don't want to be an adult right now, and I just live my life like I couldn't when I was in school.
How are things in your life now?
Well, I have a mummy and daddy, adopted mummy and daddy, who are totally comfortable with me being a little girl, and their children and their grandchildren are totally supportive. In fact, her youngest granddaughter, when I was eight, a year ago I was eight, and she was seven, and she said to me, I want you to be the little sister, so I'll be nine. I said, well, I don't mind going to six, so I've been six ever since. But we have a great time, and we color, we do kids stuff. It's called play therapy. No medication, no suicide thoughts, and I just get to play.
Big question for you. Should companies be forced to publish the wages earned by their male and female staff? David Cameron believes it will help abolish unequal pay in the workforce, but some argue there's no problem to solve. Let's get more on this with writer and broadcaster Milo Yiannopoulos and journalist and author Nikki Hodgson. Ladies first. Nikki, what do you think?
I think it's a great idea. It's brilliant that David Cameron's embraced this initiative, which I actually think came from Labour originally. You know, it doesn't need to be a finger-pointing exercise. I think that's the main point to make. This is just a really good chance to look at how boosting women's earning power can boost the economy.
You disagree, Milo?
Well, actually, I think it's a great idea, but not for the same reasons. The problem is that what most people don't realise, the gender pay gap is a sort of myth. No economist takes it seriously. The ONS figures come from broad church sort of averages across the workforce, and when you take into account the different choices women make, whether or not you include children in that, actually the pay gap narrows to zero. So I'm in favour of this only because it's going to really embarrass these campaigners who constantly tell women that they're victims and that they're suffering under this sort of patriarchal society. Actually, women and men get paid pretty much the same. To the point of a couple of percent. So I am in favour of it, but only because it's going to explode one of the most persistent feminist myths of our time, the gender pay gap.
Nikki, it amounts to zero, this pay gap.
No, I don't think that's true at all. I think the issue is that women tend to take, you know, lower paid work, more part-time work. In these kinds of companies, that's not the case, but what it is going to show is how women are not very good at pushing themselves forward sometimes in the corporate environment, and they really struggle to ask for what they're worth, and that is a problem for all of us, because ultimately that, you know, affects the economy, it affects the earning potential of these companies.
Milo, the latest figures, percentages suggest that the gender pay gap currently stands at 19.1%, which means the woman on average earns 80p for every pound a man earns.
Well, the Office for National Statistics figures are based on 1% of an average right the way across the industry, so they don't take into account the different kinds of jobs people are doing, so really they're effectively meaningless. But there's a very simple question that that demonstrates why this the whole debate is nonsense and why the pay gap is a ridiculous sort of fabrication. And it's this: if women are working, doing the same work for less money, why aren't companies full of women? Why aren't employers going out actively seeking women? Well, they don't, and they don't for some of the same reasons that that, you know, women take different sorts of roles and different part-time roles. Women don't work as long hours as men do, even if they don't have children. They take longer holidays. They don't make as much money for their firms. They don't work the same overtime. So we can't really expect them to be compensated the same as men when they don't work as hard. Now, that's not, you know, I don't mean that to sound, you know, unkind about women. Women simply have different priorities in life. Most women want a more balanced life. They want time with their family. They want to do hobbies. They want more time away on holiday. They don't want to put in the work that those sort of obsessive, aggressive, sort of goal-oriented male professions sometimes demand, the law, for example. Women just aren't really interested in devoting their whole life to work in that way. And the very broad brush figures from the ONS simply reflect that. What they don't show is that a woman going to the workplace is going to be paid less than a man for the same. In fact, under the age of 35, in the UK and the US, women are paid more in the same sorts of roles, and they're 2 to 1 more likely to get jobs in science and maths because employers are so desperate to hire women.
Nikki's not generalising at all there about how hard women work.
No, exactly. I think there's hundreds of women that won't be watching this programme because they're too busy working in order to argue with that point. I don't think that's true at all. What we really have is a social problem, a problem where we expect women to take the burden of family care, to care for elder relatives. And so as a result, they often end up working less hard, as Milo puts it, because what they're doing is they're working second shifts, third shifts, caring for other people. What we need is a culture change to allow women to be able to work just as hard as men if they so choose. And that isn't happening yet. But what would be good about publishing these results is that it would pave the way for a conversation about how society is structured so that women aren't able to function as highly as men are in some professions.
Oh, you were too gentle with him. Milo, are you suggesting for 1 second that I do not work as hard as my male colleagues? I take more time off than my male colleagues.
Well, I think,
and I am not in any way as committed as my male colleagues.
I think, and I mean this in the nicest and most complimentary way possible, you're probably atypical in most respects as a sort of workaholic of either gender. You're probably not typical of women. You're probably not typical of anyone in the kind of work that you do. What I'm talking about is not, you know, bashing women for not putting in the hours. What I'm saying is, in general, women look for different things from life. So they look to fulfill themselves, to flourish in slightly different ways. And, you know, of course, if you take the, you know, if you look at the end statistics about pay, they're going to reflect that. That's not necessarily a problem. Now, when people lose the economic argument, they always switch to the social argument, as your other guest just did. And unfortunately, the problem is that a lot of this is underpinned by this sort of constant victimhood complex that women are encouraged to buy into. They're given this victimhood script about, you know, whether it's rape culture on campus or pay under the male average. And most of it's based on ridiculous sort of social science studies that don't stand up to the most basic scrutiny. Most of it simply isn't true. And I think the majority of women don't want to be patronised, don't want to be given special privileges, don't want to be given special dispensation. They want to go out to the workplace, be paid what they're worth. And of course, you know, if they want to raise a family, they're not going to get to be CEO or not going to be a partner in a law firm. You can't have it all. You know, you can't do all of these things. And what really sort of frustrates me, and I think frustrates a lot of ordinary women who, you know, find these sorts of debates a bit dull and a bit mystifying, is that there's some sort of somehow implication always behind the scenes that being, you know, that motherhood is a bad thing, and that it's a bad thing for a woman to aspire to raise a family and to be a mother. Actually, it's sort of one of the most extraordinary things that anybody can accomplish and anybody can do. But there's this sort of assumption that, you know, well, if you do that, then we've got to make sort of special dispensation when you go back to work and pay you more and give you all these benefits and whatever, rather than celebrating the unique things that women can do in society that men can't.
He started off that answer, Nikki, by trying to compliment me and take the wind out of my sails. You
yes,
have a go.
Absolutely. I've got no time for that argument whatsoever. You know, women want to do many varied and amazing things with their lives. Motherhood might be part of that. But, you know, again, if that's such a wonderful thing to do, why are men not bending over backwards to take time off to raise their children? They're not, because the culture is not set up to encourage men to share the load of care. You know, women, even when they're married and working, do more domestic chores than men do. We've seen these surveys time and time again, and I think it's really insulting to say that women, you know, might not be as inclined to work as hard or want different things from life. There are plenty of women who are hugely ambitious. Just look at the number of graduates that we have now. Women are outstripping men. They're getting better degrees. What we haven't seen yet is culture change to accommodate and to reflect that. And I think the other thing is that it tends to be older women often that are also in part-time work positions, but we shouldn't just leave them to flounder. They're often picking up care bills for elderly parents as well as looking after children and the rest of their families. So, you know, I just think Milo's argument is ridiculous that women, you know, shouldn't be paid as much because they want other things from life.
Okay, Milo, we've been given more time, so you're going to have to work even harder. It's more than 40 years since the Pay Act. And yet still, it is a fact that women do not earn as much as men.
No, I'm sorry, it's not a fact. You can only say that if you take broad brush averages across all industries and all genders, and you can say the amount of money going to women is a bit less.
Well,
it's not.
I mean,
it's illegal to pay a woman less than a man for the same work.
Interrupt him, Nikki. Go on.
If that's the case,
then when these results are published, they won't reveal anything. They won't reveal any difference, but they're going to. That's the point.
David Cameron is encouraging it.
I want them to be published because what they're going to show is that at all stages, all else being equal, the genders are paid the same. Or even what they might show, you're saying the culture hasn't changed. I think your argument's 20 years out of date. The culture has changed, which is precisely why there are more women going to university, more women graduate from university, they're getting higher grades. They're 2-to-1 favoured when they go for job applications, particularly in science and technology. And they're paid more, depending on whose figures you believe, up to the age of 30, 35 or 39. It's probably about 35. Women are paid more than men.
But so
whatever gender pay gap you're talking about has already been fixed.
But it hasn't.
So the good news for you is that you know, there isn't a problem anymore, although there used to be, and that if we do release these figures, which I'm very excited about, they're going to prove me right. So I guess we'll have to wait and see.
But that's not true. I mean, the point is that the gap is there still, and older women in particular suffer more from it from younger women. We shouldn't just leave older women, you know, to flounder, should we? Just because they were part of a generation where it was even more difficult for them to get on.
I'm making a specific explanation about where these figures come from, and you haven't really addressed the point that I'm making. What I'm saying is that you can only create this gender gap when you take a broad brush across all genders, all sectors, all work. That doesn't reflect the different choices people make. And employers shouldn't be forced to pay a full-time salary to somebody who works part-time. You haven't come up with a solution to that, and you haven't addressed the problem with the figures, which is that no serious economist treats the gender pay gap as a problem to be solved. No economist thinks this is a problem because they realize what I'm explaining.
Is that male economists or female economists, just to be clear?
Well, I mean, most of my figures on this from is from a feminist female academic, Christina Hoff Summers at the American Enterprise Institute in the US, who looks at the figures from the UK and the US, and she does a broad survey of all economists. I'm sure of all genders, but my source for this sort of stuff is generally Christina Hoff Summers. So she is a female feminist academic who is mystified that this is this sort of feminist myth that won't die.
Good for her. Nikki, final thought to you.
I just think that we need to see the figures published, because then we can start analysing the data. You know, publishing the numbers without any analysis of it is obviously going to be a waste of time and no use. But I think David Cameron should be applauded actually for this move.
We can agree on that much.
Okay. You've both worked equally hard. Both of you submit your invoices. You both get paid the same. Thanks very much indeed for joining us.
Over the course of her career, a working woman with a college degree will earn, on average, hundreds of thousands of dollars less than a man who does the same work. Now, that's wrong. I don't want that for Malia and Sasha. I don't want that for your daughters. I don't want that to be an example that any child growing up ends up accepting as somehow the norm. I want every child to grow up knowing that a woman's hard work is valued and rewarded just as much as any man's. So to anyone who says 77 cents on the dollar sounds pretty close to equal, I say, your math is bad. You wouldn't like it if your vote only counted in 3 out of 4 elections. You wouldn't like it if your daughters or sons went to school, but they only got taught 3 out of 4 4 days a week, or 4 out of 5 days a week. You wouldn't like it if you were forced to work every fourth day without pay. Men would be complaining about that. They wouldn't think that was equal or fair. So this is the 21st century. It's time to close that gap.
Well, one of the things they told me was that he was at the house one night, and he would talk, and he started laughing. He said, "Aaron, what do you think women's liberation was about?" And I said, I had pretty conventional thinking about it at that point. I said, "I think it's about women having the right to work, getting equal pay with men, just like they won the right to vote, you know?" And he started to laugh. He said, "You're an idiot." And I said, "Why am I an idiot?" He said, let me tell you what that was about. We, the Rockefellers, funded that. We funded Women's Lib, you know? And we're the ones who got all over the newspapers and television, the Rockefeller Foundation. He says, and you want to know why? He says, there were two primary reasons. And they were, one reason was, we couldn't tax half the population before Women's Lib. And the second reason was, now we get the kids in school at an early age. We can indoctrinate the kids how to think. It breaks up the family. The kids start looking at the state as the family, as the school, as the officials, as their family, not as the parents teaching them. And so those are the two primary reasons for women's lib, which I thought up to that point was a noble thing. You know, when I saw their intentions behind it, where they were coming from when they created it, the thought of it, I saw the evil behind what I thought was a noble adventure.
Aaron, did you know that Gloria Steinem, in one of her own books, now admits the CIA funded Miss Magazine?
No, I had no idea about that. No, I never heard that.
Yeah, we're gonna
CIA funded Miss Magazine?
Funded Miss Magazine with the stated goal of taxing women and breaking up the family.
No kidding. I never heard that. Well, Nick told me. I mean, I know it, but not because I know the CIA was involved in it.
Well, Gloria Steinem was proud of it. Oh, the CIA wanted to help me help women.
No
and,
kidding.
And so they funded it. Yeah, and of course it's divide and conquer.
Right.
And
of course.
What they do is they focus in, obviously, on real problems. Women were getting shafted in many ways, but the elite wasn't planning to help them. They were planning to really shaft them and take men away from them. Look at what they did with black families. You only had about 10% illegitimacy 50 years ago. In black communities, and now it's over 90%. And look at welfare. You were going to give you some money, but you can't have a man in the house.
Right.
And so that was further to degrade the family.
Yeah.
Totally destroyed. And now illegitimacy is over 50% in the general population.
Right. Well, see, the whole thing is these people control the money. So they make all the rules. You understand? And they put whatever rules they want into effect. And the truth is America has really become a socialist, communist country. And everybody says it's a capitalist country. It's not a capitalist country. You know, how can it be capitalistic when you have a central bank? That's the first thing. It can't be. You know,
It's a planned economy.
It's a planned economy. It's a phony. If they want to create prosperity, they just print dollars. They just make dollars or put digits into the economy. And then now you have prosperity. You don't have real prosperity. You don't have real manufacturing. You just have money being injected in. It's an infusion of credit.
Which makes the government go into more debt.
Into more debt. But the point I'm trying to make is that by creating this Federal Reserve System, the government now became dependent on these private banks for money. And they started taxing us, you see. And so now what happens is that in 35, I believe it was, Social Security started. And they gave Social Security cards, said not to be used for identification, the Social Security number right on the card, right? And through Social Security, they started deducting money out of your paycheck. That was the first time they were ever could take money out of your paycheck, because people agreed to it because they thought it was going to their retirement fund. And so then when they instituted the income tax again, they started taking money out of your paycheck because Social Security could do it. And then they could do it again. You see what I'm saying?
And so now they've even taken control of the tax, the tax payment itself. I mean, literally like you're a slave, they're
right.
Taking it right there when you make it.
Exactly.
They don't even trust the public enough
to send them a check. Yeah. Right. So they take it out automatically because they know people aren't going to want to pay it. So what's happened is that through the implementation of the Federal Reserve System, the government has become vested in these bankers, and they get their money from the bankers. And so then they impose a tax on us, which makes us more slaves, makes it more difficult for us to survive, right? Giving them more profits. And now what's happened is that through the Federal Reserve System, the bankers have pretty much taken control of our government. It doesn't matter Republican and Democrat anymore, because they're both the same. Neither one of them are talking about shutting down the Federal Reserve System or stopping the payment of taxes, you know, or any of the big issues that face Americans, right? So I had a friend, Nick Rockefeller, okay, who was one of the Rockefeller family. And he, when I was running for governor in Nevada, he came to me, introduced himself to me through an attorney, and we became friends. We started talking about things, and I learned an awful lot from Mr. Rockefeller. And one of the things that we used to talk about was the ultimate plan of the banking industry, what they wanted to accomplish. And the goals of the banking industry, not just the Federal Reserve System, but the private banks in Germany and England, all over Italy, all over the world, they all work together. They're all central banks. and they're all part of the Communist Manifesto. You know, central banking is one of the major planks of the Communist Manifesto. We talk about America being a capitalistic country, but yet at the same time we have a central bank that plans everything for us, right? And the graduated income tax is another plank of the Communist Manifesto, right? So right there you have two major planks of the Communist Manifesto that have been brought in because of the Federal Reserve System, okay? So the ultimate goal that these people have in mind is the goal to create a one world government run by the banking industry, run by the bankers, and they're doing it in sections. The European currency, the euro, and the European constitution is one part of it. Now they're trying to do it in America with the North American Union, right? And they want to create a new currency called the Amero, right? And the whole agenda is to create a one world government